like to thank you all for coming. My name is Kelly. I work at the library. For the past few years, I have had the privilege of working with Music at Eden's Edge on a number of concert series, and each year they put together a special winter program for us. This year, we have a four-month series called Virtuosity. So for the next 4 months, once a month, Music at Eden's Edge will be hosting solo performances. Tonight, we have a flute performance, and our flutist is Orlando Sela. Please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming today. So, as Kelly said, I am the starter of this four-part series on virtuosity. We have three other instruments. We have, I believe, the next is a cello player, and then a viola, and then a violin, and they all have a different take on virtuosity. In fact, today I'm just going to play for you, I believe it's one, two, three, four, five pieces, which showcase the flute. Now, what I decided to do is talk a little bit about virtuosity in the time of the Baroque, virtuosity today, virtuosity in the Romantic period, etc. Just so you have a wide variety of what was virtuosity and how they explored it, okay? There's two seats in the front here, too, if you want to. I think they got it. Thank you. So, first, let me tell you a little bit about the flute. The flute, as you can see, as opposed to the piano can produce very clear harmonies. A guitar can produce very clear harmonies. The flute can't. The flute is bad. The flute is lame. Oh, you see. But, you know, the flute is very good if you have an accompaniment with it. All the pieces I'm going to play with you are meant to be played without accompaniment. And all of the pieces I'm playing with you today are supposed to be a composer take on making the flute do something that it's not supposed to do, which is to play accompaniment to itself, just like a guitar would or a piano would, okay? And I'm going to start from the Baroque period, when George Philip Telemann started to write, he was a genius, and he started to write his fantasies for solo instruments, and then he gave it a hand to the flute. He wrote 12 very amazing fantasies for the flute. We are not actually sure if these are meant to be for violin or for flute because of the writing, some of the writing. We think they're for the flute because they don't go below D. They don't go below the speech, so they think, oh, okay, maybe it was indeed meant for the flute. The Baroque flute only would go down to the D. The modern flute goes down now to the B. Okay, so we know now that it was probably meant for the flute. The violin can go all the way down to G. So he wrote these fantasies. Fantasies is, as you know, it's like write whatever you want, right? So here I'm gonna play for you fantasy number 3, which is in 2 movements, also very strange. Again, Telemann could experiment with all of these forms. And you wanna notice in the first movement, a lot of jumping from the bottom line, one note to the higher one. So he's trying to produce this sense of a cello playing, giving a little bit of a bourdon or a bass line to it, whereas there's another instrument on top. And that was very typical of the virtuosistic part of the times. The only problem is that Telemann really, really was pushing it. And you notice that in the second movement, which is a jig, it's actually a dance, and it's very fast, and it's very difficult, very likely to get that word on to happen as you're playing, you know, very fast, and you have to go back and up, back and up, back and up. So I'm gonna play this beautiful, beautiful piece called Fantasy in B minor, and it's the third fantasy, number 3, and it's in 2 movements. First one, it's a large one. The second one is a lively G. But again, that was very typical of the style. Also, the performer is supposed to put flourishes here and there, and in trills and whatnot. You're supposed to put a little bit of ornamentation as you do that. So it all makes it all more difficult. Actually, we are very lucky because the modern instrument has all these extra keys for trills and whatnot that I will use later, that the Baroque flute didn't have. So again, technology is a wonderful thing. You know, throw away your cell phones. So again, this is a way of the Baroque players trying to bring out the virtuosity of the flute players in the time. Having the impression of having two flutes in the same room at the same time. Another style of virtuosity that we find later in the early classical and late romantic period has the same idea. Now, this time, things are starting to become a little bit more chromatic, you know. By this time, the technology we already have keys, and we're able to play louder. And some composers, again, are trying to take the flute to the next level. You lived back in the, 1800s, let's say 1850, 1860, or 1890 when this piece was written, you wouldn't have a CD player, you wouldn't even have a record player, right? That things came later. So the only time you would have music at home is if you made it yourself. You had to play your instrument. And many families, especially educated families, that was understanding that they would play something. Composers wrote these incredible operas and incredible symphonies that then were arranged for piano or piano for hands or you name it, right? So that you can play it at home and hear that wonderful newest, ballet by somebody, and then you can play it at home. And some composers wrote things to be played at home. Some of them play flute incredibly well, like Johannes Dungeon, which is the next composer feature here. And again, he wrote this piece in the late 1800s. He was a flute virtuoso, and he wrote etudes. Etudes are practices for flute, basically. And these ones are not particularly boring. He wrote a set of six called Salon Etudes. And as the name has it, it's supposed to be played not only as an etude, but can also be a performance piece. You can play it on a salon. You know, you will get your friends, and maybe they will bring their instruments, and you will play a little bit, I play a little bit, then you play, meanwhile we're drinking and eating, etc., etc. It's a chamber music party style, 19th century. So what he does is he takes what Telemann was doing of having two flutes, and he really expands it. Here you have it in a much, much more extensive way. This is a very thick texture. It's not so bouncy. It's romantic. It's in a minor key. It comes with a poem that transliterated, basically it means, my love right now is like the leaves in autumn, taken by the winds through the streets. Right? So sad, right? So anyway, it's a very sad poem. It's a very sad poem, as you can hear. And what he does is the way he textures this piece, you can really hear the rolling of the wind. You can hear the picking up of the leaves, or the picking up of the leaves and putting them down and putting them down. So I'll play this for you. And again, just there, you keep your your ears open for that movement of this floating line that has a very complicated and very elaborate accompaniment below it. Thank you. So much different than the telemans, you can hear, right? It has this rolling quality, and it has what I call a heart underneath, almost, like some kind of circular motion that it keeps going and keeps going and keeps going. And again, this is one of six that are of incredible difficulty and extreme variety of characters. This one is definitely my favorite. It's very fluty. Yeah, it's amazing. You have all the wonderful skills. This is really a very good, very good for you flute players out there to play this. I don't know, any questions so far? Since I know we're supposed to be Close Encounters, I will open the floor anytime for questions. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I missed the name of the composer.
His name was Johannes Donjon, and it's D-O-N-J-O-N. I didn't know, I would have brought a printed program, maybe next time. Yeah, Johannes Donjon. Yes, ma'am.
What nationality was
he? I am not sure. You stumped me with that question. I think German, but could be Austrian as well. So I am. I will look it up. Sorry, I don't know. Good. Yeah, but I will play a German composer next to make it up for you, okay? And again, we're talking a very Germanic composer. Virtuosity as well, very virtuosic, but in a completely different fashion. If you ever heard Scriabin in the piano, where now the harmonies are being really pushed forward, this is your guy. His name is Siegfried Kardeller. Again, wonderful composer.
Excuse me.
Wonderful composer, especially of works for organ. He wrote some flute works that are of excruciating difficulty, such as this sonata. Now, the term sonata, when we think about it, is usually three movements, sometimes four movements, right? And it's very long. This one in per se is not very long, but it does have what they call sonata form. It has two very distinct things that happen in a certain order, and in the middle, maybe about two-thirds in the way, there's a development of these things. The only problem, again, is that he's doing writing this for flute alone, something that he wants to sound like an organ. A lot of voices, a lot of harmony, and very complicated harmony. A lot of the times, you seem to have this flowing line that then gets very confused, very obscured by these lines that are so complicated with harmony, and they finally arrive home. They finally arrive to the resolution. And the way that he does it is masterful. It is very difficult, and one needs to time this very carefully and make sure that one arrives very carefully, lots of space in between. This is a one movement sonata. So it's only about 6 or 7 minutes long. It's actually a very, very, very short sonata, but it is very intense and very dense in the harmony and in the lines. In fact, one can say that here there is really a lot more than just one flute. I mean, there's probably not only two flutes, but two different characters. You know, there's the character, for lack of better words, for lack of better onomatopoeias, I don't know. You know, so there's two, again, this is my favorite Mahler piece for flute solo. Let's put it that way, right? Again, it's intense, it's beautiful, it's gorgeous. This was written in 1913. So again, he's really pushing the harmonic envelope. He's really pushing it. At the end, he says, go as fast as you can. I mean, he's really pushing it. The name is Sonata Appassionata in F-sharp minor, which sounds very scary. And it is. F-sharp minor is very scary. Appassionata, again, just put it all out there, you know? And again, it makes it very difficult. There's a lot of technicality, but again, there's a lot of passion, there's a lot of story here, there's a lot of drama. I don't say anything else. We can talk about it after.
Thank you.
piece by Don John, right? And again, it's still the same Germanic tradition, but again, you can see this one is informed now by a lot more different influences. We have now lots more chromaticism. A lot of times where you have seven notes in the space where six notes should fit, or sometimes nine notes in the space where six notes should fit. And again, the idea is to just throw the audience into this, you know, the harmonic and rhythmic confusion that makes you really inhale, exhale, and take you to a very different place. Any questions, any comments? Did you like it? Do you like this music so far? Great. I feel like we're going so fast with this music. I was hoping to talk more. I don't know. Yes, ma'am.
Which one is the most difficult to play so far?
The most difficult so far, I think, is this one. For many different reasons. Especially the last page. Like all of these composers that are wonderful writers, they forget that flute players need to breathe for a living, right? So there's a lot of... By the time when he gets to the end, you know, the last page has no rest, and says go as fast as possible, and then it gets louder and louder and louder, and you're gasping and you're dying. Ah, that's so appassionata, really. It's not the end. If you happen to survive it, it's wonderful. This one is very difficult. Having said that, everything has its difficulty. For example, with the Telemann that I played at the beginning, that's another entire style of difficulty. You know, that I have to be mindful of the time of the time period and the style of how they would play certain dances and what they would do and how they do the ornaments. And something with the classical piece that I played for you, it's a completely different, it's like playing a Mozart concerto where you have to be very delicate. It's all very transparent. It's like handling Yadro glass flower or something, you know, something very, very, very delicate, as opposed to this one where this is, you know, you have to be very, very powerful, very all out. The dungeon was all in, and it was all very controlled, very, very, very controlled. Any other questions? In France. Oh, I was so wrong. Thank you so much. I think the name Johannes threw me off.
Yeah.
Please, somebody say me too. Great, okay, so I'm gonna play now a piece that it is challenging both for flute players and audiences alike. This is not not a very commonly played piece. It's by an Italian composer called Salvatore Sciarrino. And again, it takes this theme of two flutes, two voices, in a completely different direction. This music has two stabs for the flute, sometimes three. And the third one is just to have an explanation of the sounds that he's looking for. Again, this is contemporary music, so it has a lot of extended techniques, or how we professional call it, so it's a lot of squeaks and farts. So it might be sometimes difficult to understand it. And don't worry, it's shorter than it looks because it has twice as much. So it's not nearly as long. And I'm gonna explain a little bit about this. It's called Canzona di Ringraziamento, or the Song of Gratitude, right? Salvatore Sciarrino was always, or is, he's still alive. He's a very, he's an enthusiast of mythology, especially of the Greek, but also, you know, the Egyptian mythology, you know, the Sumerian mythology, you know, Babylonian. So in this case, he takes this as a Egyptian song to the sun, or to thankfulness, okay? to great gratitude. The imagery here, it's really amazing. You can see, this. The way I see it is, there's this imagery of people, of murmuring, which you will hear. And the next thing you hear is this shimmering of the sun, the Egyptian sun, bearing on you, which is as you probably imagine, is very, very hot. So the piece only uses two, maybe three techniques in the whole entire piece. He uses these two little trio keys that we have here. There's two little keys here that open two keys in the back there. And those are the trio keys. You use them to trio. So you have them there. What he does is he uses them to create this shimmering effect. Or as I call it, the dove effect, you know? And turtle dove effect. And it's very simple. There's really no trick to it. Except I'm just fingering normal note. Right? And then by doing this, I'm breaking the air at very quick intervals, right? Right? Then the other thing he does is by shifting these two keys, he switches very quickly between the F and F sharp on the G. So one is G to F, one is G to F sharp. And then when you mix them, you get this other kind of shimmering effect. So that's one of the techniques he uses. The other one, again, this is fantastic because now he's thinking of two flutes. The one hand flute, which is doing something, and this guy who's just tremoloing. I mean, he's thinking about the flute as two, really, literally two different instruments. The other section of it is he's using different fingerings for the same note, very, very, very high, to produce the same note with two different colors. And he switches between them very, very quick. This is called a timbre trill. So this note can be played like this, or like this. You hear that? Can you hear that? So there's all of these trills that happen like that, and that will happen around through the piece. So this piece goes like this. One of them might be the shimmering sound, and the other one is the murmuring of people underneath, you know, praying, you know, and the whole entire piece is just a play on these two things. You might feel very long at one, and sometimes the creativity that he does with the changes in between the speed and everything, it is fascinating. So I really hope you enjoy it. say, no, there is no melody. And I think they mean it that way. Again, we have arrived at a junction in music where, I mean, it's hard. I study music history a lot. And you can safely say that there's a very straight path from, you know, the Renaissance. There are certain things that survive, or they go out of the history path and they're obscure, and they come back. For example, you know, during the medieval and the Renaissance period, there was this composer, Gesualdo. Have you heard of Gesualdo? Gesualdo was famous for two things. One, he wrote music that was harmonically extremely complex. He did whatever he could please. And two, he killed a lot of people and never was prosecuted for it. But again, he was some kind of Italian baron, and he was able to get away with it, right? So his music never, is so advanced, so chromatic, that uses harmonies used by 1950 American composers, right? And that's how advanced he was, or how crazy he was, depending on how you want to label him, right? But you can, there are things that, you know, go out of phase or don't survive, and then you have, you know, the transition between, you know, the counterpoint of the medieval and the Renaissance, and then that starts to become a little bit more baseline with the basso continuo, and that gives way to the baroque, and then the change in thought starts to get rid of all these complex and you know, and all these complicated lines of the baroque, and it starts to streamline into the classical period, and then it starts to get very chromatic, very powerful, very, how can I say, it's all from the heart into the romantic period, the beginning of the Beethoven and then the Brahms, you know, the myth of the struggling composer and life and rah, right? So, and then you get to the 20th century and all of a sudden it explodes in all sorts of directions, right? There's no longer a straight line. Schoenberg says, I'm gonna organize all the 12 notes of the chromatic scale in a way that there's no tonality. And it goes that way. And then Debussy says, you know what, I'm not gonna do that. What I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna use Greek modes and modes from Bali and Indonesia. And he goes that way, right? And then there's a group of Italian composers that decided to start to experiment with electronic music and created this, I mean, so all of a sudden in the 20th century it goes kaboom. Right? And where you get 20th century music, which is absolutely gorgeous, and for example, the music of John Harrison has melodies and has harmonies that are very, very likable. At the same time, this man is writing like this, right? Where it's no longer about having a melody to listen to or to grab onto. Right now, the important thing is just playing with sound, playing with sound, playing with sound. And again, this is one of the many, many branches of contemporary music right now. There's another contemporary music that is based on world music of different, you know, countries. And they, it's very influenced, for example, Takemitsu, Hosokawa, they write works that are meant to be Japanese in essence, but with a lot of techniques like the one I just played, with a shimmering and powerful attacks, etc. So yeah, this music, it's a very, very different style from the ones that you have heard. And again, once you're doing this with your fingers for about 10 minutes or 8 minutes, which is how this long this piece is, you know, it's a different kind of virtuosity too. Also, everything that he asks for is extremely soft. Notice that I never almost played loud. Everything he asks is has to be. And it's a very different, it's not like Carl Geller saying, I'm in love and I hate it. No, this one is like, listen to my music. You know, it's a very different approach to music. Yeah. Any other questions? Anything? The other thing I really like about Chorino is that he's really using the flute in many, in very different ways. He has come up with some other techniques that are fantastic and fascinating. Like tongue wraps, like you throw your tongue into the flute and you produce all of those sounds. Or jet whistles, which is more or less what you do when you're warming up the flute. you get those tones, you know, like. You know, you get all the, you know, all of the organs. It's fascinating, all the things that it does. But again, that's what composers are doing right now. They're trying to push the envelope. What can flute players do? What can the modern flute do? And let's see how we can make it as difficult and as interesting as possible. You know, mostly so that they can get a job with tenure in some university. But they are really, really struggling. They're really, really pushing it. Yes,
ma'am.
Can
you explain the piece like telling the piece, which you said was an early period? Do you play on flute from that period, or do you use your live flute? And the second question, which has to do with first.
Again?
You mentioned chromaticism a few times. Can you explain what chromaticism means to
live
musician?
Great questions, both of them. So the first question is, I do play baroque flute too, as well. But I decided not to bring it today because this fantasy is a little difficult for the baroque flute for my level. I've been playing this instrument for 30 years plus, whereas I've been playing the baroque flute for only about 5, right? The key of B minor is doable, but I thought that in order to explain better, I wanted to get rid of that difficulty of that instrument and do what it was more comfortable for me. Also showing that even when this piece was written, you know, I would say 350 years ago, in a modern instrument, it still needs a certain degree of virtuosity, a certain degree of difficulty. When it comes to chromaticism, to answer your second question, in the Western style music, there are 12 notes. We call them chromatic scale because, like saying a rainbow, it has all of the 12 tones. So, those are the 12 notes of the chromatic scale. However, when you're playing music like Telemann chooses those very carefully to produce harmonies. Maybe choose two or three, right? Whereas chromaticism might be a lot of colors all together, you know, that make you go, I don't know, crazy with all the variety of colors. It's an overload of harmonic intensity. If that makes sense. So it's a lot about obfuscation. Is that complicated enough for you? I don't know. Maybe it was not very clear. Diatonicism. Meaning, imagine using only the white keys on the piano. And then imagine using all the white keys and all the black keys all the time, constantly. So yeah, diatonic pieces are very typical of folk music. In fact, sometimes it's even pentatonic, which is simpler. Like Chinese music. All of that has no chromaticism at all. In fact, I'm only using five notes to play all of that melody, right? As opposed to, right? Where it's, right? It's a very difficult, very different feel. So yeah, diatonic. I want to take a little tangent because this is very interesting. The first flute was found about 10,000, it was made 10,000 years ago, something like that, give or take. And it was found in Slovenia, and it was made out of a bone of, they think it was a bone of a bird or something, you know. So it was a teeny little flute, like about this big, out of a bone, and that's how it survived. It was fossilized. And it has four holes in it. So they copied it, and they measured it, they copied it, they reconstructed it with everything, and the notes were something like this. I mean, it was completely diatonic. It was, right? It was incredible. In fact, it's something so ingrained in our cultures that you can go anywhere in the world and you can hear a lot of this diatonicism in all the cultures of the world. It's Peruvian culture, Sub-Saharan music, you know, it's incredible how it all stays there. Great, any other questions? Okay, well, I only have one more piece of music, and it's in the longer side of it. And this is just to wrap everything up in one entire blanket. So what I'm going to play for you is called something that is not for flute, believe it or not. But again, that's another part of virtuosism for flute that was done. Usually, the music for other instruments is so much better than the music written for flute that we steal a lot of it. So, this one is called the folie d'Espagne, le folie d'Espagne, okay? Or la folie, right? Written by the French composer Marin Marais. You know, it's been taken, it's a theme, beautiful theme that has been taken by many people and been arranged and disarranged, you know, and he composed it and it's been decomposed by many other people in order to make a completely different piece of music. So, it's a theme and variation. And what I've done here is I found a set of variations by another arranger, the arranger for flute, and I arranged those variations for myself, right? So some of them are going to be a little bit strange. The interesting thing about this was written in the time before telegram. This was a long time ago. It was written for something called a gamba, or a six-string cello-like instrument that you would put in your legs. And that's why it's called viola da gamba, or a leg violin, right? You put it within your leg, and then you would play. And he wrote this melody. Why he said Le Folie d'Espagne? It's because he's writing the theme, which is based on a Spanish dance called a saraband. And a saraband has a very, very standard form, which is the second beat is important every other measure. You're gonna hear a little bit, like one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, 2, 3. And that's how it goes. Then la folia, or the craziness, happens after that. There's all these variations that happen based on this thing. And the virtuosism part of it is, you're supposed to hear the theme regardless of what happens in these variations as they get increasingly more and more and more complicated, giving you a sense of familiarity, and at the same time is, look what I'm going to do, how I'm changing with something that you're familiar with. Variations have always been a favorite. Goldberg variations, right? Theme variations were a favorite of many composers, you know, Beethoven, Bach, you name it. So, I'm gonna play this and then we can talk a little bit more about it. I know it's been a rather short evening after this, but I think we can talk a little bit more and then, you know, we can discuss more. I can play something else. I can play something else from the what I've played before that you might be interested in talking about.
Thank you. Thank you. What stays constant in all those variations?
Wonderful question. The length stays constant. Believe it or not, everything has, first of all, the same amount of measure. You know, it's what can I say? It's a 16 bars, always 16 bars. Whatever happened, it happened within 16 bars. That never changed. The other thing that never changes is the triple rhythm. So the sarabande is always in three. Even when you're hearing, it's always one, and that two, and that three, and that one, and that two. Sometimes it's milling, it's just that you hear. It's actually. So the player is playing 6 8 notes in three beats, but instead of playing three groups of two, they become two groups of three. Understand? Does it make sense? So instead of playing one and two and three, it becomes one and that two and that one and two and then that two. Understand? So it becomes two groups of three as opposed to two, two, two. You know, so three, three. So that remains constant. The other thing that remains constant is always the harmony remains constant. So even though if I'm playing different notes, for example, the beginning, the first bar is in E minor, and the second bar is in B major, and then back to E minor. So if I'm playing, that's still in E minor. B major, and then back to E minor. However, the only reason you know it's the same is because you have heard the same harmony now by about 17 variations. And there's something to be said about in the flute, which is, get ready to be really confused. If you thought this was confusing, implied harmony, which is the illusion that you're hearing the harmony that you're supposed to hear. If I play this for you, you don't necessarily have to hear this. You hear that E minor because you have heard it many, many times, right? If I play, I've changed, it's the same B, but now I've changed the key just by virtue of adding extra notes. So I've changed the implied harmony of that B. If I play another B, that B is now sounds different because I just changed the key in your ear. Does that make sense? So we have a lot of memory that short-term memory within pieces that allows us to play around with your expectations of what to hear. In this case, after you hear, he's spelling the harmony with you. So if I play, even though when it looks very groovy, you still hear the harmony. It's still within your memory, which is psychologically fascinating, if you ask me. It's incredible. Any other questions? Any comments? No? Yes?
Yes, I want to thank you. First of all, the music is fascinating. It's beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
You're so accomplished. And also, you're an excellent teacher.
Oh, and you were very kind. Thank you very much.
It's so much complicated material. It's understandable.
Oh,
thank you.
I'm glad that my accent didn't get in the way either. Yes, ma'am. No, don't be asked.
Is there a difference when you play, when you have to read the music and when you play just by heart? Do you think of something different?
You know what? I tell you, my New Year's resolution is to play everything by memory, okay? Obviously, but I studied all of these pieces that I can play them by memory. But I make too much mistakes. I get nervous, right, if I don't have it. So I just have it this for what is it called? Reassurance, kind of like a crutch that I'm eventually trying to get rid of. Now, if you are reading something, you know, you are processing it a certain way, right? There's a certain process that goes from the ear, from the eye, you see it and your fingers go with it and then the sound gets produced, right? But by learning it by heart, then it's part of yourself, right? So there's one less step. So when I'm playing, which I know by memory very well, that one I know by memory very well, it becomes part of me, so I don't have to rely so much in the page. When you see somebody playing in an ensemble, like in the VSO, they are probably just, you know, processing something from the page off as opposed to having made it part of yourself when you do it by heart. That's why I want to memorize everything I play, just to make sure that I really, really, really understand it and grasp it and own it, and it's mine. That's a great question. So maybe next time I will don't have to bring the music stand on the paper, which is a hassle. You know, that's the other good practical thing. As a flute player, I bring a lot of stuff, as you can see. Go ahead, this is great.
Can we organize something for us? I think the flute is great for water music and wind music.
Wind music and water is great, okay.
Can you try something on water and something on wind?
Sure, I'll be happy to do that. It's funny that you asked me to do that because one of the things that I do in my contemporary music life is I experiment on improvisation using folk music traditions. So the Saturday before, the 16th, I was performing in an experimental music place, and I did an improvisation on Indian style music, right? So I'll improvise something for you, rather short. I mean, I don't know how we're doing on time, but I will do something very short with these themes of water and music. Hopefully you will hear, hopefully not. This is my interpretation of this. Yeah, I do a lot of contemporary improvisation. That's my other life. You know, I'm supposed to play this beautiful written out music. Sometimes I make it up as I go. Great. Thank you very much. Thank you.